Fresh off a 2005 season with the greatest margin of victory, reigning two-time Top Fuel champion Tony Schumacher came into the 2006 season with a full head of steam. Would anyone be able to run with the Army team? The consensus at that time? Probably not. If drag racing was only about qualifying, Tony would have had a killer start. In six of the first 10 races, he qualified number one.
Check it out, 4.459. Say hi to your new number one qualifier in the quickest Top Fuel car in the history of Firebird Raceway.
But four of those six times, he lost to the bump qualifier in the first round.
Big upset, Tony Schumacher has gone down. The number 16 qualifier, Alan Bradshaw, picks up his first round win.
And the other two times, he failed to make it through round two.
And Fuller does it again. I don't know what happened to Tony Schumacher. He had been living in the 440s. The cars just seemed to move off the line and then just stop. Look at Alan Johnson in the background there.
He can't believe it.
Qualifying takes one run. They take your best run. And we can go one run down the track, but if you don't get down the other three, you cannot win the race. It takes four great round wins to put a Wally on the shelf, and we just weren't getting it. We just had no karma.
Whether it was bad karma, new tires, or something else, the Tony Schumacher-Alan Johnson team inexplicably failed to win, or even runner-up, in the first 11 races of the 2006 season.
It was just a tough season, and what makes a great team is not the dominance. It's being able to step back and smile and go, we'll get it, calm down. And people were writing us off. And we got to the point where we were 336 points out of the lead halfway through the year. But there was still a long part of the season to go.
There's the Sarge, Tony Schumacher.
And so with just 12 races remaining, Tony Schumacher began to play catch-em and launched what would become one of the most incredible chases in the history of this or any other sport.
Well, that's Schumacher with a 472, 316 miles an hour.
Beginning with the Midwest Nationals, Tony and his team would finish first or second in each of the next five races, picking up Wally's at St. Louis.
And Brandon goes away, and Tony Schumacher finally gets that win.
And again in Seattle.
It's time to light this candle. Tony Schumacher is on the line.
If one were prone to believe in miracles, perhaps it was time to begin entertaining such a belief.
Well, it looks like Schumacher's year is turning around.
There was enough time left. And Bob Fry was great, man, because I used to buckle in a car and we'd go to start up and he'd say, and here comes the freight train. Because we were catching them, it was cool.
The march forward for Schumacher and his Army team continues.
The freight train roared into Indianapolis, historically one of Schumacher's most successful venues for the 2006 U.S. Nationals. And right on cue, Tony won the event, taking out J.R. Todd, David Grubnick, Hot Rod Fuller, and Brandon Bernstein along the way.
Oh, what a drag race, and the win goes for the fifth time to Tony Schumacher.
Everyone, including points leader Doug Kalita, were beginning to sit up and take notice.
We weren't just doing good. Coletta was also doing great. So you can win every race if they're always getting to the final. You're not gaining on them like you need to be. But we were gaining on them 45 points a race. And it was actually great because it was going to lead to amazing moments.
Schumacher in the left lane. Doug Coletta, the points leader, in the right lane. The gap right now is 85 points.
As the season wound down, Tony continued to charge and continued to put pressure on the drivers ahead of him.
Oh, wow, things just got a lot more interesting. Look at the
and for perhaps the first time in his career, Tony knew what it felt like to be the cowboy wearing the black hat.
Everybody was pulling against him. Doug Coletta's a great guy. He's the nicest guy I'll ever meet. We had won so much. You know, they hated us. The Army car just wins everything. Well, people were like, yeah, Doug. And all of a sudden, we were catching him. I mean, we had everybody trying to knock us down to help Doug. And I love that. You know, I love Doug, but my job's to get past that. And I will guarantee you, if I can't win a championship, I'd love to see Doug do it. But the game wasn't over. And until the fat lady's singing, man, I'm battling.
And so the drivers came into Pomona for the final race of the season, with Tony trailing Doug Kalita by 45 points. The stars would have to align perfectly for Schumacher and company to have any chance of three-peating as Top Fuel champs.
Everyone said, what are you going to do? And I said, we're going to show up at Pomona. We're going to qualify number one. We're going to set a world record. We're going to win the race. If Doug goes to the finals, it doesn't matter if I do all that and cartwheel. He's going to be the champ. I'm going to walk over and I'm going to shake his hand, call him the champ, make sure that ring fits him, and congratulate him on an excellent season.
The air was thick with drama, but it was about to get even thicker.
And I'd be lying to you if I told you there wasn't a person in place wasn't hoping that Doug Kalita would win this. He is arguably one of the best drivers ever.
As Saturday night gave way to Sunday morning, all the chips were on the table.
We got up in the morning. I remember walking out, and I told my guys, we might pull this off. We might not, but enjoy this moment because this is it. This is the greatest moment I have ever had. We haven't lost it. We haven't won it, but look at the situation we're in. And we started out, went out, won first round. He won first round. We won second round. He won second round. Third round, I had to watch him right in front of me run my teammate Melanie. He goes out and wins the race. He's a champ. That's it. Doesn't matter if we set a world record or not. And he ended up getting beat right in front of him.
The wind light goes to Melanie Troxell in a hole shot.
He just got to stop and breathe because we could do this. And we are going to do this. And that is why we showed up and why we prepared for this particular moment our whole life.
When he has to be perfect, he's perfect. When he's got to rise to the challenge, you don't have to say anything. All right, Tony, this is a big one. He knows, and the guys around him know. And the team's in sync. They always rise to the challenge, and that's when Tony's at his best.
So with two rounds to go, Tony finally controlled his own fate. Of course, all he'd need to do was win both rounds and in the process set a new national record.
Both daunting tasks. I mean, Pomona is not a track that is normally prone to give you national record-setting times. But in the strange way that NHRA scores the record, you have to back this up within 1%. You know, he could win the race, he could not back up the record, he could lose the race, he could win the race and run too quick and not get the record. All these little things that were sitting in there, and I will never forget sitting in the tower saying to myself, I hope he doesn't run too quick.
Didn't matter who I had to run, I had to set a world record at Pomona where one car in the history of Pomona's 50 years had ever set a world record. When I was getting in the car, I remember Army recruiter, and he leaned over and said, on the phone with a Blackhawk, they're waiting to hear if you pull this off. And I remember just laughing, thinking, I needed that, needed more pressure, but we're a great pressure team. If we do this, I'll be the last guy in the world to know. I might see my wind light, but I don't see the scoreboard. I will be the last guy that'll be heard around the world, including a Blackhawk circling Baghdad, and I won't have a clue.
Take a look at the numbers. Schumacher, 4.42 seconds. Look at the heartbreak.
That final race. Last run and to set a new world record was just remarkable. And Tony did a great job of driving that car down a racetrack that if he would have gotten a little bit out of the groove, if he would have made any little mistake at all, wouldn't have mattered. So everybody on that team stepped up to the plate and hit a home run. That run. And that's why it's known as the run.